Hello, and welcome to the Cute Syndrome Foundation's 6th annual SCNAA Clinician, Researcher, and Family Gathering. Also, our first virtual gathering. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to ask you all to hang with me here for a bit. We're not going to start late. Recently, I had reason to write to the FDA. I opened my letter to them by explaining that I'm tired. I suppose at the end of 2020, the idea of being tired of all of this isn't particularly novel. However, when I said I was tired, I wasn't speaking to coronavirus. I sent my letter to FDA on a Saturday after spending my evening talking on the phone with an exceptional mother about the difficult decisions ahead of her as she contemplated her son's care from the PICU after status and a 25-minute cardiac arrest. This is her son, Milo. Milo is absolutely a superhero. His strength and determination in his recovery thus far is nothing short of breathtaking. Not all of our children do recover, though. This is Varia. Isn't she perfect? She completely stole my heart, as did her mother, who was determined to help her daughter no matter what it took, no matter what the doctor said. Varia died on November 5th, the second child in our community to die in a single week. She died while we were attempting to coordinate remote access to expert care, after weeks of her seizing 40 times a day, resistant to rescue medications, regularly being resuscitated by Ambu Bag by her mother. As I explained to the FDA in my letter, I'm not tired of being there for our SCNA Day community for these moments. In fact, it is one of the great honors of my life to support these families in moments like this. But I am tired of these things being normal for our community. So in consideration of throwing out what's normal here, let's recognize that this gathering is not like any other. Those of us who understand this event know that what has always made it special is connection. It's the unexpected interaction with a child with SCNA Day or their sibling. It's the understanding that comes from hearing a child have a seizure in the back of the room as a scientist talks about his or her research. And it is, yes, in true Cute Syndrome form, in the conversations at the bar after the event that illuminate the kinds of unexpected truths that we couldn't find unless we just came together as curious, compassionate humans, not just medical professionals and researchers, but families too, all wanting to help those with SCNA Day. These connections, they help focus us. So this year, as a team, we focused on what there's to gain in a virtual setting. We've cut back the formal presentations in favor of conversation. We've shortened the event. We have people joining us today who could never join for an in-person meeting. people from all around the world, people who couldn't otherwise travel to be with us. Like I'm sure you guys have already figured out, based on the noise next to me, for the first time in six gatherings, my daughter Esme. Esme, can you say hi? Can you say hi, please? Give me a smile. Let's see. Ah. She's not playing along. But she is happy to be here. And we are all here to advance the understanding of SCN 8A in ways that improve the lives of those affected by it. Perhaps sometimes the paths there are indirect. They can be found in unlikely connections, like the ones made by this unforgettable young man.
Hi, I'm Billy Cohn. I miss you guys. I miss you. I love you. I miss you. You're so cute.
Billy, what's the name of what you have?
Cute syndrome.
What does that mean?
If I said what?
What's it mean if you have cute syndrome?
I'm so cute.
Ladies and gentlemen, Billy Tone, in the full version of this video, which you can watch together with all of our children's videos in the expo or over break in the videos. You can see that Billy goes on to draw a picture of Shelley from Canada, who is my second in command at the Cute Syndrome Foundation, as well as Dr. Johannesson, who we'll hear from in a bit, who both of whom Billy met last year in Baltimore and who stuck with him. And he stuck with them as well. Dr. Johannesson remembered Billy specifically in the pre-gathering educational series for our families a couple of weeks ago. These links, they're important. They drive us. For the last 5 years, we've asked all of you to come into some big room at AES with us, lay eyes on our children, listen to them, smile at them. And I know how much that has touched so many of you. So today, throughout this meeting, we're going to bring our children right into your offices, your homes, to guide you in videos made by their parents. And what better guide than this young man, Nico, who many of you may remember meeting in D.C.
My name is Eva. I'm Shahi. I have as C-A-H-A-A.
I learned how to talk this year.
I am 4
years.
Years.
Seizure.
Seizure free. And your
thank.
Is
say thank you.
Free. Fix you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nico wants to say thank you because his gains, guided by an understanding of his mutation, have helped him communicate and demonstrate his intelligence. His pride, his visible pride, makes me think about what really matters to our children. You may all remember Casey Craig's talk in New Orleans when she shared the notion of having to choose between seizures and smiles when she thought about medication for her daughter, Stella. And here's Stella, introduced by her big brother, Lincoln.
Hi, my name is Lincoln, and this is my little sister, Stella. I want to keep her smiling and giggling, but increases to her current meds take them away, and we don't want that to happen. So can you please make a medicine to keep the smiles and giggles here and take seizures away for good? Thank you.
Good job, Stella.
Just over the last few days of gathering planning, Casey and Stella were in for an overnight EEG, and it's clear that Stella may require another medication increase due to increased seizure activity. And the question Casey is asking is, will Stella be able to giggle on the other side of that? This is what matters to Stella. It's what matters to her mom, to her dad, and certainly to her big brother Lincoln. It's what matters to me. And it should be at the heart of how we advance science, expert clinical care, and drug development for these children. Life presents us with all manner of things to get bogged down in. But my job here today, and in general, is to orient us. It's been a long year. There have been some devastating hiccups. Some we've all felt, and some have been more intimate. However, there is also something about moments in time, like the one we're living through, that are crystallizing. They give us perspective. They help us understand what's really important. They help us understand what we're all doing here. Let me introduce you to a friend of mine, Cam.
Be the last one standing, two hands in the air, I'm a champion. You'll be looking up at me when it's over. I live for the battle, I'm a soldier. Yeah, I'm a fighter like Rocky. Put your flag on your back like Ali. Yeah, I'm the greatest, I'm stronger. Bet my dues can't lose, I'm my own, yeah. Hey, I've been working my whole life. And now it's done.
When we live and work in a world of children like Cam, like Esme, who do things that are certainly impossible for them, when we live and work with mothers who find the strength to literally push life back into their own children's lungs repeatedly, there is no question about who we are here to keep up with, who we are here to focus on, and how to talk about what actually matters. So today, together, let's run at this like Cam. And in that spirit, we're gonna get started.